How'd you all enjoy lunch? Good? Yeah? Okay. So our next speaker is a senior research fellow at the Foundation for Government Accountability, which is a foundation whose name alludes that it has some noble intentions. He's made a name for himself as an economist focusing on microeconomic studies. At FGA, he researches how government regulations on the private sector affect the labor market. So before being at FGA, he was also a research fellow at the Manhattan Institute. He has also worked as a research assistant for the political philosopher Douglas Rasmussen. Meyer co-authored the book Disinherited, How Washington is Betraying America's Young, a book that dives into how the economic policies of the federal government help older generations at the expense of millennials. He's also the author of Uber Positive, Why Americans Love the Sharing Economy, which counts the struggle Uber has had with unions pushing for government regulations to allow the taxicab unions to thrive while simultaneously stifling the ingenuity of Uber, harming the company and consumers in the process. So Myers testified before various congressional committees, including the Joint Economic Committee, House Education and the Workforce Committee, House Budget Committee, and the House Judiciary Committee. Myers' research has been published in outlets such as the Wall Street Journal, Forbes, New York Post, and National Review. He's appeared on many radio and television shows, including the BBC World Service, ABC, Fox News, and NPR. Meyer received a BS in finance and a minor in the philosophy of law from St. John's University in New York City. In 2016, Meyer was named on Forbes 30 Under 30 for law and policy and has starred in a PragerU video entitled Why You Love Capitalism. He has spoken at a number of Young America's Foundation events in the past. And with that, I am pleased to hand to the podium, hand the podium over to Jared Meyer.
Thanks. Thank you. Well, I guess I've got the spot after lunch, but we're going to keep this really interesting. I promise I have three videos to show you and only one graph. So don't worry, it's going to be very interesting. And I'm also very impressed with YAF and all of you. I do a lot of talks for student groups, and I don't think I've ever had a lecture start on time. So good job being all back in your seats. But because I promised this is going to be interesting, I'm going to start my talk off how your smartphone's making government irrelevant with a story. But I guess it's not really a story, it's more of a rant. So have any of you ever flown on Frontier Airlines? I'm really sorry. Why did you make? Yeah. So I was doing a talk down in Atlanta, and I decided to give it a shot. I'm like, this is a cheap airline. Let's go see, you know, save some money. It'll still hopefully get me down there. Well, little did I know, long story short, after onboarding and offboarding three different planes, trying to figure out what was going on, 4 hours later, I was so frustrated, I took out my phone and tweeted to all my 20 followers about how insanely terrible Frontier Airlines is. I was like, I don't care if it's cheap, don't do it, never do it. Finally, within a minute, I had a response from Frontier's account asking me what's wrong. I'm like, oh, let me tell you what's wrong. So as I start complaining about all the times that I've had to get on and off another plane, they're telling me information that the gate agent was somehow incapable of giving me for the last 4 hours. So when I finally got down to Atlanta, I got about 2 hours of sleep. I was really mad when I woke up. I had to go to my talk. I was exhausted. And I checked my phone. And I had an email from Frontier that said they were refunding my flight, and they gave me a credit that was enough for me to fly round trip to Mexico for free. Let me just say that if this has happened to any of our parents, they would not have gotten a free trip to Mexico. This is what technology's doing to the economy. It's giving consumers more power and also giving workers more power. So one more story. I grew up in Minnesota, and my mom would go to a store called Goodwill and buy old sweaters to sew into mittens. Now, she'd go to craft fairs on the weekends and maybe on a good weekend sell a dozen pairs. I mean, thankfully, it was just a way to make extra money for Christmas. It wasn't really trying to support our family. But imagine all the things my mom would have had to go through to build up her business back then. She'd have to find a much better supplier than Goodwill. She'd have to figure out how to market her business beyond craft fairs. All the things that she would have to do to try to grow her business, it would have been really difficult. But now today, she could hop online and with just a few clicks of a mouse, have a store up on Etsy that could reach people all over the world. This is another side of technology. And to use one economic term, if you're going to remember anything from this lecture, remember that technology drives down transaction cost. So transaction costs are all the time, energy, and effort to find someone to trade with. And to explain this, I like to just tell this story. So this is called Airbnb in the 1950s. Airbnb existed back then, believe it or not. It just was very inefficient because transaction costs were way too high. Like, if I was doing a talk out here in Reston, theoretically, I could go and knock on people's doors, ask them if they had a room to rent, try to figure out how much they were going to charge me, probably ask for a reference to make sure they weren't going to kill me while I was sleeping. But, like, Airbnb was possible. The reason why it didn't take off, again, was those high transaction costs. So that's why when people ask me how I define the sharing economy and all these cool new things we're seeing, I think it's just the natural result of lower transaction costs. And it's not just short-term rentals or ride-sharing. It's everyone who's now more able than ever before to work for themselves, and consumers who are able to have access to new products and services that they simply didn't have access to in the past. And this is the one graph that I promised I was going to show you. I know it's hard to read, but all you need to know is this green line's pretty much flat. Those are the number of people who are filing tax forms with the IRS if they work as employees. So in America, you're either an employee or an independent contractor. Employees, you have a boss, you usually punch a time card, but you get things like minimum wage, overtime protections, workers' compensation. But this red line is people who work as independent contractors. Those are people who are their own bosses and partner with other companies as clients. As you can see, there are actually fewer employees in America today than there were in the year 2000. All the growth we've seen in work has come from people who are working for themselves and filing these 1099 forms. And that's what I think you would expect. Do you ever wonder why large companies like JP Morgan have thousands of employees? Economic theory tells us that every transaction should just be one-off with the perfect person to do it. The reason, though, why these firms grew and had lots of employees and we ended up with all these decades of federal and state labor law was because the transaction costs of finding the perfect person to do each job were too high. Like, let's say if Yaf wanted to redesign their logo, which, I mean, looks fine to me, I don't think they need to, but if they did, they would probably go out and hire a graphic designer and have them on staff full time. Even if, let's say, they only had 30 hours of work for them to do a week, maybe formatting a letter they're sending to donors, you know, working on the new logo. But today, I think another option that they could use is going and finding the perfect person just to do that one job on a site like Thumbtack, for skilled professionals being able to connect with individuals. This is how the economy is changing, and it brings up a lot of interesting points with the role government should play. So I talked about how the workforce is changing, and to contrast this, I want to talk about my grandfather's workforce. So this last year, he turned 90 years old, and I went up to his birthday party, and my grandma had set up this table for him with all these things throughout his life. You know, they had his high school graduation picture, they had a baby picture, they had him in the army, and then they had this ring. So I asked my grandpa what the ring was for, and he explained to me that every decade that he worked at Northwest Airlines, when he went, or where he went as soon as he got out of the army, they would give him a tie pin with a diamond on it. And after he worked there for 30 years and retired, my grandma had it built into a ring for him. And he was so proud, talking about his career and everything he accomplished. And because it was his 90th birthday and I wanted to be nice to him, I didn't say what I was really thinking, which is, you had this same job for 30 years, Grandpa? Like, that sounds absolutely miserable. I get bored after like a month of doing the same thing. I don't know how you did that for 30 years. But that was our grandparents' workforce. In the era of high transaction costs, it made sense to go on and give up your freedom and flexibility in order to work as an employee for someone. But what I see this is a lot different from what I call hipster capitalists. So I went to school in New York City, and I was up visiting one of my friends who still lives there and walking around Brooklyn. And I saw this shop that, no joke, only sold pickles. It was like a pickle store. And not only was it a pickle store, all these pickles were like $10 for one pickle. I don't get it. But so apparently this, you know, hipster entrepreneur saw some market need I didn't. But the idea that you can create these projects now, or these products that only cater to a real niche or niche, or however you say that word, market, that's something that's made possible because of technology. I assume there's some people in Brooklyn who are willing to pay that much for a pickle, but now because you can reach people all over the world, you can make things like mittens out of old sweaters from Goodwill and have a large market even if the people don't live around you. That's why you're getting all these crazy millennial brands that would have never flown before. You can work, as I said, towards a smaller market rather than creating mass appeal things. And that's opening up a lot of options for both consumers and workers. So as we talk about how work's changed because of technology, this is a dramatically oversimplified chart that I made of how work has changed throughout all of human history. I left off hunter-gathering, but let's start with agricultural. So yeah, not a very good way to grow an economy. Industrial, a much better way to grow an economy. And a lot of pundits now say that we're in a service economy. Even if that's the case, I don't think the future of work's a service economy. See, because of embracing free market principles and the ability of people to create wealth through trade, we're moving to an era where we're so wealthy, we're gonna be in an entertainment economy. And if you don't believe me, this little kid right here made $8 million last year playing with toys. If you would have told, my grandpa would have told his father that when he grew up, he was gonna play with toys for a living, or even cook. And I mean, do any of you like watch people playing video games? No. This is one of the only times when I feel really old because I don't get it at all. I've even seen, there's videos of people watching people watch people play video games. Like that's, it's like some endless loop of, but anyways, these are the jobs of the future. We're going to have, we're so wealthy, we can now just pay to watch people put on makeup like my wife does every single night. Like, I don't get, these are the jobs. Even if our grandparents would have told their parents that they wanted to be a chef, that wasn't a prestigious profession in the past. It was a low-wage position that didn't have much social cred to it. But now, chefs are some of the most respected people in our economy, and because we go out to eat so much more, because we have so much more money, these sorts of entertainment jobs, along with some service ones, I think are really where the economy's going in the future, which I think's exciting. But switching gears a little bit, I want to go to a quote from my good friend, Senator Bernie Sanders. This is from 2015 when he said, "I'm not a big fan of Uber. You can quote me on that." And the reason Senator Sanders said he was not a fan of Uber was because he said it was completely unregulated. Well, on that point, I want to show you the first video, then we can get into a discussion of different types of regulation.
Drivers rate you, just like you rate drivers.
They rate
you? Yes, they all do it. Open up the app and then check my rating. And mine is 5.0.
Oh, perfect. This is why you wanted to play the game.
Yeah, I'm bragging, right? Right? Sure. I earned it.
Okay, we get it.
I'm a good passenger.
Great job.
4.8, you both have 4.8.
I got a 4.6.
Oh. That's okay, that's fine.
Do you ever argue with the driver? Like what direction to take?
If they're going the wrong way or something, sure.
But... Ah, that's usually what it is. Like you have to sort of like play it cool, let them.
5.0, in your face. That's a 5.0.
Calm down, Millie, act like an adult.
Of a 4.6 should be telling me how to behave.
It's not a moral barometer.
It is. It's how you treat other people.
It's very insignificant.
It's very insignificant and silly, but Carrie, we haven't heard your rating yet.
That doesn't matter.
Did you check it? Just go into settings.
Can't be worse than a 4.6,
right? Can I get the check? Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
It's not even a big deal.
I can't hear you.
I didn't see it.
This is a 3.1.
I'm sorry. She's all the way over there in this breakfast noise.
It's a 3.1! Okay? Are you guys satisfied? Who cares? Who cares? Wow.
You're taking off?
Yeah,
you guys are leaving?
Yeah, we gotta take off.
I understand. We'll see you Tuesday, I think, right?
Yeah, Tuesday.
Sorry. 3.1. I didn't even think they could rate that low.
Could you?
So that video is obviously a little bit of an exaggeration, but I think it brings up an important point. And before telling you what that is, I think just in the issue of transparency, I should show you. You could probably like trust me with your pets. I'm an okay person. I've got some things I need to work on, but you know. But the idea that Senator Sanders calling Uber unregulated, which it mostly was in the terms of government regulation back in 2015, was that he was missing that government isn't the only system that can regulate. We also can regulate things as consumers. We have market regulation and government regulation. And too often, people like Senator Sanders just only knee-jerk reaction go to government regulation. But if you think about it, when you go out to eat, do you go and check a government's like food safety inspection score website? Or do you go on Yelp or Google reviews or talk to your friends on social media, or I don't know if Foursquare's a thing anymore, but like, you know, Snapchat, any of these ideas. You can use other ways to hold companies accountable than government. To give you an example, so in every transaction, there's three parts. You have the decision of whether or not to buy something, which consumers control. You have the decision of whether or not to sell something, which companies control. Then you have all that information about a product or service. Now, a lot of the justification for these consumer protection regulations that we see all throughout the economy was that all that information, it was heavily skewed towards businesses. Businesses knew more about their product or service than we as consumers did. That's what advocates for government regulation argued. But if you think about what technology's done, it's taken that information and brought the seesaw or teeter-totter or whatever back in balance. We now have access to more information than we ever did before as consumers, and that information is power. And I'm not saying that companies are going to regulate themselves, but what I am saying is that consumers can increasingly hold companies accountable. Think back to my Frontier story. If that would have happened before the peer-to-peer online connections we have through Twitter, what could I have done? Like, called my mom and complained to her? Like, Frontier's not gonna care about that. But when you get a real opinion maker tweeting out to their 20 followers, Frontier pays attention and businesses adjust their behavior. So I think an important thing to understand all of these changes is the role that trust plays in the economy. I should have asked earlier, but how many of you are economics majors? Or okay, so not many, but this is really all you need to know about economics. You're not gonna trade with anyone if you don't trust them. And pretty much every institution we've set up is to increase trust. So back when we were all cavemen, you only traded with people you personally knew. Your community was your economy. And that's a terrible way to grow an economy. As the economic students know, you can't really take advantage of division of labor, and then you can't have someone like me just go around and talk about economics for a living and somehow get fed. I don't produce anything, yet I'm able to eat every single day. So that was not possible back in the community era, and that's why we didn't have any economic growth. But then we had this great innovation. It was large, centralized institutions that made it so that all you had to do was trust that institution, and you didn't care what they did then as long as you trusted them. So for an example of this is a bank. When you put your money in a bank, you don't know who they're loaning it out to. But you don't care because you trust the bank or the government's backing of the bank. So this was the era of things like large banks, as I talked about, large companies, things like religious institutions, government. That was their era, and it led to a massive growth in our standards of living. But as technologies continue to evolve, and now that we can communicate with each other as peers over the internet, I think we're leading to the information age. This is where now, like with the Uber rating, you know, the silly example, it is true though that when you're looking at a product, we're much more informed than we were in the past. This information, as I said, is power. But we're quickly even moving beyond that. I don't want to do a whole lecture just on blockchain technologies, but as we move to the type of technology that underpins things like Bitcoin, we're not even going to have to worry about trust because things will be verified in a decentralized way. So I'm just pointing all this out to say that government loves this era. They love the era of institutions because that's when they created value. That's when they really helped the economy grow. But as we continue to switch and move forward, unfortunately, government stays in the same place. And as my other very good friend Taylor Swift said, regulators are gonna regulate because that, do you guys not listen to Taylor Swift anymore? Do I like need this? Yeah, I know, I need to do it better, like sing the song. But anyways, regulators, what they view themselves as doing is regulating. That is how they view their job description. I've worked with countless ones, and doing nothing or saying, let's see what happens with the market is not really in their job description. If you don't believe me, I've got quite a few stories to share with you. The first one is of a company called Flight Now. So I talk about planes a lot because I have to fly like twice a week at least, and I really, really hate flying commercial, except I'm not rich enough to fly private. So I'm in this really tough situation where I absolutely can't stand dealing with TSA and flying commercial, but I don't have a ton of disposable income. So these entrepreneurs behind a company Flight Now saw a market segment like me and thought, hey, we could help these people fly private in an affordable way. So if any of you have ever been to a small regional airport, there's these bulletin boards that are up where pilots post where they're flying to, on what day, and how many seats they have. And they'll say, hey, if you want to come along with me and split the cost of the flight, let's do that. It's something that's been completely legal for decades. But going back to our discussion of transaction costs, how many of you want to drive to a regional airport, look at the physical bulletin board, just hope that someone's going where you want to go, and then be able to get on that flight? Those were really high transaction costs. It was like Airbnb in the 50s. It was possible, but people didn't do it. What these entrepreneurs did was take that physical bulletin board and move it online, dropping transaction costs exponentially, dramatically. So what happened was, even though they were doing something completely legal, remember, those bulletin boards had existed for decades, once they moved it online, the FAA, who regulates commercial flight in the US, called them in. And they said that they had to comply with all the same regulations that, like, things like Delta Airlines or Southwest has to comply with. Even though all this company was doing was taking a completely legal service and moving it online to make it more efficient. This case made it almost all the way to the Supreme Court, but unfortunately the Supreme Court declined to hear it. So FlightNow doesn't operate in the US anymore. What really makes me mad, though, is there's a company called Wingly that's based in France, and they're expanding all over Europe doing this same thing. So France has out-freedomed us when it comes to flying private, which really, really annoys me. Another thing, I think this is something to keep in mind when we talk about innovation. So someone like me, who couldn't afford to fly private, would have been able to do that with FlightNow. The idea, though, is that anytime we have these innovations, I think the main beneficiaries are people who didn't have options before. If you look at things like Uber, it's not corporate executives who all of a sudden have access to private car rides. They could already afford them. What Uber does is extends these transportation options to underserved communities. And to prove this, I actually looked at every single Uber ride over the course of a year that started or ended in New York City. And the fastest growth was seen in low-income, outer borough neighborhoods where taxis were nowhere to be found. It's pretty common sense, yet you had regulators in the city, led by the mayor, Bill de Blasio, trying to push back against this growth, this, I think, really progressive growth that allows low-income people to have access to transportation options. He was instead focusing on downtown and midtown Manhattan, claiming that these services were increasing traffic. But he was ignoring all the people that are helped by technology. So whenever you hear debates about technology just making a bunch of, you know, millennials wearing hoodies out in Silicon Valley really rich, the main beneficiaries are people who didn't have options before. But do any of you have dogs at home? Oh, good. So have any of you heard of Rover.com? So Rover is like an Airbnb except for pet sitting. And this service, it was growing, and I ran into a woman in Colorado named Lisa Jacobson, who, she's a single mom, and she was in between jobs, doing a career transition, but she needed a way to make money because she had one son in college and she had her mortgage to pay. And then she realized she had worked in the past with dogs that had experienced a lot of trauma. And she thought, oh, I could partner with Rover, set up a profile, and earn some money and stay in my home and help my son stay in college by signing up with this service. So she signed up, and within just a few weeks, she was the highest rated pet sitter in all of Colorado Springs, Colorado. And everything was going great until something happened, which is going to be kind of a theme in this talk. The government showed up. She got a knock on her door from a representative from the Colorado Department of Agriculture, and he informed Lisa that she was participating in unlicensed commercial kennel activity. And Lisa was like, oh, well, I want to fix this. Like, I need this money. I need to stay in my home. My son needs to stay in college. What can I do to comply with the law? Well, he said, you got to pay $400, but then you also have to pave your entire house over in concrete and your backyard, because you're not allowed to have grass, wood, or carpet in a commercial kennel. So Lisa really wanted to keep her job, but she couldn't pave her house in concrete, and she also didn't want to go to jail. So she made the tough decision to shut down her business, and overnight, her income dropped to zero. And something to point out with this is, it wasn't just Lisa. She got so frustrated, she reached out to people at Rover, and she found out that all the top-rated pet sitters were getting this same visit from the representative from the Department of Agriculture. And what was in common was the large commercial kennels in her town were losing business because Lisa and people like her were offering better service. I know I've never had a dog growing up, but from people who I talked to, they said that some dogs can deal with, you know, being in kenneled for a week, but other ones who have had anxiety or emotional stress, they need something maybe like a large backyard that Lisa had, or working with someone where they're not in a concrete floor. You know, it's about different options for different people. But so finally, these people were all very upset, and Rover actually tried to get a law passed that would have legalized what Lisa was doing. So Lisa went to testify in favor of this law. And at the hearing, the sponsor of the bill asked that Department of Agriculture rep, you know, sometimes my daughter over the weekend will watch her friend's gerbil while they're out of town for $10. Is my daughter breaking the law? And he actually said, yes, she is. That watching someone's gerbil, like seriously, watching someone's gerbil for $10, you need a commercial kennel license and have to pave your whole house over in concrete. This is what regulators are doing. New opportunities to work, like through Rover.com, because again, of lowering those transaction costs, you can find someone who can watch your pet that works out perfectly for the situation you have. Those should be celebrated. Instead, we have regulators standing in the way. And this also touches on something that I think discusses how regulators have stood in the way of the consumer empowerment that comes from technology, and that's occupational licensing. So I'm sure a lot of you have heard of the minimum wage or you've heard of unions, but only about 3% of Americans earn the federal minimum wage, and only less than 7% of private sector workers are unionized. So that's not a very large part of the economy. Now almost 30% of Americans need a government license to work. So occupational licensing is the biggest issue facing the American labor market. And licensing is effectively needed to get that government permission slip in order to enter an occupation. And you might be thinking, well, sure, you know, doctors, lawyers, accountants, we're all good free market people, but we should have some sort of regulation on them because they could, you know, kill people or ruin them financially or make them spend their lives in jail. Well, that's how it was back in the 1950s, when only 5% of workers needed a license to work. But as I said, we're up to 30% today. We have everyone from tree trimmers to interior designers to florists to door repairmen to 1,100 different occupations now being licensed by at least one state. And as we talked about, remember how information is in consumers' hands thanks to technology? We would expect, given the developments that have happened, that we go from 5% of workers licensed maybe down to like 2% or 1%. But instead, government has somehow completely ignored this trend in consumer empowerment that really brings into question a lot of consumer protection regulations, and instead we're up to 30%. And to give you a little idea of what these regulators do and to prove that they regulate for the sake of doing so, I want to share with you the story of one of my friends, Juan Carlos.
We had this great young person, Juan Carlos Montediasco, who was out giving haircuts to homeless veterans. And he was doing it because, one, he wanted to help people. His mother had been someone who was stricken with cancer, and he just has a heart of gold and wants to help other people. But he also was working towards his cosmetology license, and he wanted to practice. And he received a letter from the cosmetology board to cease and desist, and they summoned him to Phoenix. He lives in Tucson, so that they could hold a hearing, fine him, and really stunt his career.
I was inspired by a guy in London who helps the homeless on his days off, and because of him, you know, I do this here in my community, and hopefully other people can start in their communities as well.
Juan Carlos is a loving and caring person. Now, out of his own free will, comes here and does haircuts. And when he's not doing that and nobody needs a haircut, he sits around and talks to people. Takes his biases out of the way, listens, offers any advice if he can. It's just, again, a really magical type of person to be able to do that.
I think he's a great barber. He listens to what you want. He'll do exactly what you want on your hair. He doesn't tell you what to be done. He does it.
Not only do you give a vet a haircut, it gives him more confidence. to be able to go out there in the world, you know, maybe get a job, you know, your interviews, be able to walk around without looking shaggy, let's say. You know, so he does that and gives the vets the ability to do that. And it's, you know, but he definitely got a special place here with us.
He comes in as a friend. He talks to us. He, you know, almost like a counselor. You know, he listens. He's like part of the family here.
We want to hold Juan Carlos out as a hero and someone who's making a positive difference in our community. And why would you use the power of the government to stop his career and fine him? Had we not been here, had we not made some of the cultural changes that we hope to make over the next year and a half, that kind of thing goes on all the time in government. And luckily, that one came to our attention. But part of it is we think we've done it inside the agencies in terms of changing the culture and letting people know that we want to move at the speed of business.
I think that lawmakers should allow students to provide charity without fear of punishment. Thankfully, Doug Ducey intervened on my behalf and sent a letter to the board calling their investigation outrageous. When I show up to cut hair and, you know, and I see the transformation that I do, it just comes second nature. Like, it's just something that was given to me, and I strongly believe in that, and that it's a gift, you know, and it's a gift to be shared with other people, and we should never be scared to do something to help somebody else because of the government or because of somebody getting in the way. I say live your dreams and help people along the way.
So I think Juan Carlos's story is amazing, and it brings up how, again, regulators tend not to look at if he's posing any danger. Like, how many of you had your parents cut your hair when you were growing up? Like, yeah, people cut hair for free all the time without people dying in the streets. But with licensing in general, at least cosmetologists are licensed in all 50 states. As I said, there's 1,100 occupations licensed by at least one state. But out of those, only 60 occupations are licensed by every single state, which means that, like, on its face, obviously over 1,000 of these occupations don't need to be licensed for public safety. To give you an example, interior designers only require a license in 3 states and DC. Yet the average time they have to train is 6 years to be able to legally work in those states. And I know you've all heard of the epidemics of people dying from ugly drapes and mismatched pillows in the other 47 states, but clearly this is not a role for government there. And what you can find, just to compare it, so 6 years for interior designers, 30 days for emergency medical technicians, people who are literally holding lives in their hands, they can work after 30 days of training. But yet we have 6 years for interior designers. And this is something that I think highlights what a lot of government regulation does. As I talked about, because of technology now, the role for government in a lot of consumer protection regulation should have decreased. But why does this stuff keep increasing? And the answer is that a lot of special interests who want to keep out competition will go to the government and have the government set up barriers to entrepreneurship. And this entrepreneurship should only be getting easier, like with my mom's story, as technology continues to drive down transaction costs. But to show you, returning to the interior designer example, Florida was holding a hearing to actually expand their interior designing licensing. And a representative from the American Society for Interior Designs, what I would call like a special interest trade group, actually testified that if we just licensed interior designers nationwide, we'd save 88,000 lives a year. And when I heard this, first I was like, oh no, I guess I'm on the wrong side of history. I've been pushing for a reform that leads to 88,000 people a year dying. But after doing a little digging into this number, it turns out that she got it because the Center for Disease Control and Prevention says that 88,000 people a year die from hospital infections. And according to her logic, if you just had the right people picking out, you know, after 6 years of training, linoleum for hospitals, no one would die from hospital infections. But what's crazy is this claim went unchallenged by lawmakers. And this is how we've ended up in actually adding to our regulatory burden when technology should be lessening it. And the last licensing story I want to share with you is the story of Sandy Meadows. This is actually the story that made me decide to not go and work on Wall Street after school and instead work in policy. So Sandy was a widow living down in Louisiana, and she hadn't worked for a few decades before her husband passed away. But she needed to support herself after she became a widow, So as she says in her own words, I worked every job in Walmart. And just nothing seemed to click. She was bouncing around different stores. And then one day she found a job working in the floral department at a local Albertsons grocery store. And all of a sudden things just started to work for Sandy. She found out she had a talent at arranging flowers. She loved working with the customers. And within just a few weeks, she was managing the entire department. She went from unemployed to bouncing around Walmart jobs to then managing a floral department. This is something that should be celebrated. But if anyone knows what's coming next, then the government showed up. A representative from the Louisiana Horticultural Commission, which is a real job, showed up at the Albertsons and told her manager that if Sandy didn't get a license to be a florist, he was going to have to shut down the store. Well, Sandy, just like Lisa, knew that she needed this job. She had to stay in her home. She had to support herself. So she said, of course I'll get the license. And she went to take the test. And unfortunately, Sandy failed. So she took the test again. And she failed a second time. And after failing the third time, her store manager had no choice but to let her go. And now I'm sure many of you are thinking, wow, Sandy must be really bad at arranging flowers. Well, let me just explain to you how this test worked. It was judged by a panel of existing florists completely subjectively, and this led to a pass rate that was half the rate of the pass rate of the Louisiana bar exam. So to put it a different way, it's twice as hard to become a licensed florist in Louisiana as it is to become a lawyer. Yeah. So, and I should point out, Louisiana is also the only state in the US that licenses florists. And they still do it to this day. Again, this year, a bill that I was working on to undo floral licensing failed again for some reason. But anyways, Sandy was able to find help from a group called the Institute for Justice, a nonprofit legal firm that fights for people's ability to earn a living. And she was taking the state to court. But as her lawyer told me, the last time he went down there, Sandy had no air conditioning in her home because she couldn't afford her electric bill. She didn't even have gas on her stove, and her water was close to being shut off. Sandy was completely destitute, out of work, not able to access basic utilities, all the while just waiting for her lawsuit so that she could just get back to work. But that was the last time her lawyer saw her, because Sandy actually passed away a week after that. She passed away alone and in poverty, out of work, also that a few florists in Louisiana could set up some ridiculous barriers to competition that keep people like her out of work when they have absolutely no threat to public safety. And I mean, that story still makes me so angry every time I tell it, but I should probably change the mood a little bit because we do wanna, you know, not be depressed after this talk ends. And this is what I think is one of the funniest quotes I've ever heard in my life. It's called, it says, digital is a fad. It will only work in Europe. And this is from another real job, the US Post Office head of digital innovation. And what's interesting about this quote is it was said in 2011. This wasn't someone in like 1990 being like, oh, what's this internet thing? But the reason why we found this quote is one of my friends is an entrepreneur, and he started a company called Outbox to deal with taking all the annoying aspects out of mail. If any of you have noticed, like, mail is mostly ads. You don't really get that much important stuff. So my friend set up a company where you would have your mail forwarded to them. And if there was anything important, they'd open it, scan it, and send it all to you in one PDF. And if you needed the physical copy, they'd then mail that to you. It was all about just making mail more pleasant and taking away all the junk mail you get. Well, everything was going great. Then he got summoned to the US Post Office, where they told him, I'm sorry, we have a monopoly on delivering daily mail, and if you get it delivered to you, you're breaking the law. And he was trying to say, why don't we collaborate? We want to make you more efficient. There's so many ways we could save costs. And this is where we got this gem of a quote, that digital is a fad, it will only work in Europe. So this idea that we see from regulators pushing back against technology, it might seem really frustrating, but I think there are some positives here, in that it just shows how out of touch regulators are. And government, to be truthful, like, it moves at a linear level. Government's slow, almost by design, thankfully. But technology's not slow. Technology moves at an exponential level. So there's this innovation gap where we're able to innovate around pointless government regulations. If you think back to Uber, I still can't go out on the side of the street in DC and wave down a car that isn't a licensed taxi. But it doesn't matter because technology allows us to make prearranged rides as easy as hailing a car. Or if you look at the post office, they still have a monopoly on daily mail. If you don't believe me, try to set up a competing post office. But you have companies like UPS and FedEx and these entrepreneurs, not to mention email, texting, any of these other services, has made the post office nothing more than the butt of jokes about government inefficiency. So I think the reason for I'm optimistic we can outpace regulators, but one of the things that regulators do is they fall prey to this things will never get better than they are right now fallacy. And I don't know if any of the economics students in the room know the technical term for this, but I've never been able to find it. But it's something that's just prevalent with government. And if you don't believe me that this is a fallacy, here's a nice example. So that was the first cell phone from the 1980s, the Motorola Dynatech. And that thing cost $10,000, had 30 minutes of battery life, and stored 30 contacts. The average American would have to work 500 hours to afford that phone. 500 hours of hard work to get that phone. Now we have the iPhone 10. I mean, the battery life still sucks, but it can store unlimited contacts. And what's more important, the average American only needs to work about 20 hours to afford this phone. So people had to work 1,000 hours to buy that thing versus 20 hours. This is innovation. Things do get better when entrepreneurs are free to try new things. But this isn't always the case. Keep in mind these two pictures. Now, these are two phones from equal distance of years apart. One's from the 1930s and one's from the 1970s. And to tell you the truth, I honestly don't know which one's from what, but I guess that kind of helps me make my point, which is they're not different at all. Because over this time, the government decided to discourage competition by effectively creating a monopoly and guaranteeing them a rate of profit. So what happened was when there was no incentive to innovate, you have this. When there is an incentive to innovate, you have this. So I do worry, though, because a lot of times regulators don't encourage this innovation. This is a quote from London's mayor, Sadiq Khan. And he's talking about how he didn't want London's black cabs to go the way of the red phone booth. And what he meant by this was that these black cabs are iconic. They're like New York City's yellow cabs. And I don't want innovation to push them away. I think they're cute. Well, that's not how you make policy, is promoting things and keeping inefficient things around that someone thinks are cute. That's not how we should do it. But that's not the view everyone has, as you can see from this great coalition and their video that they made.
Support the coalition of obsolete industries. The coalition of obsolete industries needs your help.
I used to have to clean people's toilets, empty them from the alleyway behind their house, and now flushing toilets and plumbing has taken away my job.
So I'm a farrier. I'm concerned that my business stream is drying up because people are no longer using horses as their primary transport method.
Save the VHS industry from being put out of business by technology.
I've spent hundreds of thousands on my VHS inventory. Now what am I going to do with it?
Dumb thing called electricity has taken over my profession.
What the coalition of obsolete industries, save the milkmen.
Is this a joke?
No, not at all. This is my livelihood.
There are many industries needing taxpayers' support. Progress is taking our jobs.
The Council of Obsolete Industries is standing up for jobs.
We're trying to stop progress from happening.
Stop progress?
Yes.
Technology is taking our jobs and we've got families to feed.
Can't stop progress, I'm afraid.
Progress?
We don't believe in progress.
If we don't stop progress, how will anyone ever have jobs?
Probably all right with not signing that one, hey?
But.
Well, the taxi industry is getting a bailout because of Uber and the competition. What we're saying is we should get bailouts too.
I don't understand why taxi drivers are being subsidised. Milkmen didn't get a fair go.
The taxi industry is getting bailed out, and I believe I deserve to be bailed out. Thank you very much. Thank you for not supporting progress.
So I love that video, and I would show it even if it had absolutely nothing to do with my talk, mostly because I love the Australian accents. But I want to talk about, again, this idea that regulators think things will never get better. Even if they do, let's say you find a rare regulator who thinks that things are going to get better, and technology and entrepreneurs are going to change the world and make it much more friendly to consumers and workers. Well, here's an example to run through. this is kind of how I view how music has evolved. You know, we've got records, 8-tracks, cassettes, CDs. Let's say you were made the music czar of America. What would you predict is going to come next if looking at this innovation? What a lot of people were saying was going to come next after this was, wait for it, mini CDs. Just like another CD, but 60% of the size. That was what they thought the future was going to be. But to show you how unpredictable markets are, who would have ever thought that this is what came next? Absolutely nothing. We don't own our music now, we just stream it. Like, I don't know, how does that even work? There's no way that anyone could predict that this is what was going to happen next. And if you had people like the CEO of Microsoft, Steve Ballmer, saying that there's no way the iPhone's going to work, pretty smart guy, being completely wrong, how can we expect some bureaucrat to figure out the future of the economy and all the benefits that are going to come from innovation? And this isn't that every new product is going to be an iPhone and every entrepreneur is going to be Steve Jobs. I mean, in fact, we get progress precisely because of really crappy, terrible products. All these things contributed to the iPhone. I mean, who thought watermelon Oreos were good or purple ketchup? Like, no, but all these bad ideas and the ability of entrepreneurs to try new things and fail, that's what drives the economy forward. And the model of entrepreneurs, it's innovation. The model of regulators is to be slow and push back against things, again, by design. So when we're looking to how to grow the economy and how to take advantage of all this newfound consumer empowerment and abilities to work, we need to be looking to entrepreneurs, not to the government. So I guess you could have a question then to conclude with, what should the government do in the smartphone era? Well, could do this. I mean, I'd probably be pretty fine with that. But there's other things that the government still can do. Rather than picking the means by which entrepreneurs need to try to meet customers' needs, I want regulators and government to focus on the ends. If we go back to occupational licensing, rather than saying that you have to train 4 years to become an athletic trainer, let's just set up a test to see if you're proficient or not. If we truly care about public safety, let's only look at things that actually contribute to that, rather than giving these litany and pages of regulation that there's no way entrepreneurs can figure out if they're breaking the law or not. So it's about setting ends and leaving the means to meet those ends completely up to the market. As an example of when the government didn't do this, as one more flying example too, there's this company, Boom Supersonic. And they're working on building a plane right now that'll be able to fly more than the speed of sound, which we haven't had since the Concorde went under, which the Concorde was very loud, because you know when you go above the speed of sound, you get a sonic boom. But that was decades ago. Now we have so many advances in materials and fuels and just technology in general that you can fly a supersonic plane today at anywhere between 1/100th and 1/50th of the noise that supersonic planes had back a few decades ago. But they can't fly over land in the US, and as they're trying to get the money to set up and build, ramp up production, they're losing out on a lot of routes because you can't fly supersonic over land in the US because of a law that Congress passed. And sure, supersonic booms were very loud in the past, but if we're going with my model of government, what the government should have done was set a sound barrier. Say you cannot be louder than this. What did they do instead? They set a speed limit. So it doesn't matter what entrepreneurs can do, you cannot fly faster than the speed of sound. We actually fly slower today than we did in the 1970s, which again drives me crazy. I would love to be able to get from DC to LA in 2.5 hours, which would be possible if we would just allow supersonic flight over land. And to tie this into one more thing that I mentioned earlier, people will say, well, this is only for the rich. We shouldn't support this. Let's not lift the supersonic speed limit. Well, everything starts out as only for the rich because it's really expensive to develop new technologies. But every single time throughout history, things that were only for the rich end up trickling down and being affordable everyday items. So another thing you might say is, well, Jared, your ends not means is super radical. That'll never work. It's never been tried. But I want all of you to take out your phones right now and look at the apps that you use on a daily basis. Does anyone have an app they use at least once a week that wasn't created in America? I know I have one app on my phone that wasn't made in America. What's your?
I think this is, I use this app to contact my family all the way in China, so I think it's crazy.
Okay, that can count then. Well, what? Yes, Spotify. There's a reason, though, why everything else was made in America. And that's because this idea of letting entrepreneurs be free to meet customers' needs and only coming in when something goes wrong, that's what Bill Clinton and the Republican Congress did in the 90s. They were like, oh, this internet thing. We don't really know what it's going to be used for. We don't know how it's going to end up. But we're going to step back and have this light touch regulatory framework and only come in when things go very wrong. I mean, could you imagine if you needed to get an occupational license to create apps? Like, there's no way Snapchat would be approved. I can just say that right off the bat. So this idea, not every country took it. That's why America won the smartphone revolution. But are we going to continue to do that with things like 5G, the Internet of Things, driverless cars, vertical takeoff and landing, autonomous flying cars, you know, all these ideas, drones that are going to come? Are we going to take this idea of regulation, the light touch framework, and come in when things go wrong and then win that era? Or are we going to fall prey to what regulators too often do, which is thinking that they can understand the economy, they can plan for the future, or that things are never going to get better than they are right now? I hope for the sake of all of us as consumers and workers that we're able to keep gaining all the benefits that technology gives us, and hopefully, you know, government will realize that the smartphone's quickly making them irrelevant. But I've got 10 minutes if any of you have any questions. We covered a lot, so. Yeah.
Hey. So I'm a mechanical engineering student, and right now that requires a professional engineering license once you get out of it in order to be able to sign off on designs for safety, things like that. But because of 3D printers and milling machines become affordable, we're starting to see a movement of people who are wanting to do like sort of homebrew inventions. How do you think that the government is going to react to people being able to produce their own hard goods, which have recently been regulated, you know, cheaper?
Not well, but I think one of the things, I mean, you're obviously much more of an expert on this than I am, but I think something to keep in mind too is it's not just government acting on its own because of change. It's that a lot of the producers of these parts feel threatened by it. They might want to take advantage of the technology, but if it threatens their profits, they may end up running to government to try to convince government to not allow it. Also on licensing, like, I try to focus on the dumbest, least defensible ones right now. But even when we get to things like engineers, where they have different requirements in every single state, I mean, let's just look at the average, and anyone who's above the average, as long as there aren't people dying in the lower states, like, we don't need all that training. It makes it really expensive and really time consuming for you to become an engineer, and I'm sure you're learning a ton, mm-hmm. but government doesn't exist to ensure like service quality or, you know, competence. It should exist only to protect public safety. So on this point, I was testifying in favor of a bill in Nebraska that would have lowered their cosmetology training requirements in barbers just to the national average. You would have thought like the sky was falling. These people were freaking out. Everyone was coming saying, you don't respect my profession. You know, we need all this training. It was all people from the schools who get extra money, of course, from the extra 800 hours they require. But anyway, someone honestly said, we need those extra 800 hours because we teach people important things, like how to market their business, or how to save for retirement, or the importance of voting. And I'm like, yeah, those are all really great things, but that's not the role of government. Like, licensing and consumer protection regulation is supposed to protect consumers, not help you figure out how to market your business better. Like, those are all useful, but we shouldn't require them. So, yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, thanks for your talk. I was just wondering if you could comment on net neutrality and what your thoughts are on that.
Yeah, so I get this question all the time, and it's really interesting because it is possibly the boringest, most arcane policy debate that could ever exist, but because John Oliver talks about it all the time, now everyone knows about it. Like, pretty much the debate over net neutrality is who should enforce net neutrality. Should it be the FCC, which is what President Obama decided to do when they used Title II and deemed it under that, for this heavy touch regulation making it a utility, or should the FTC do it, which would come in and act when companies use anti-competitive behavior. So I support net neutrality, but I do not support the FCC doing it and using a 1930s regulatory model to try to ensure it. I'd rather have it be where it is right now, where it's at the FTC, and if companies use deceptive or anti-competitive business practices, then the FTC can come in. So I think it's kind of a boring debate, but it's really become very politicized, obviously. But pretty much whatever John Oliver said is like completely wrong. Like, it's really frustrating. It's very funny, but very wrong. So.
Okay, thank you, everyone. Could we have a round of applause for our speaker?